like Shannon said, it is my anniversary, so, and I'm very excited to be here.
How many years?
We've been married 3, we've been together 6.
Awesome.
So, I love my wife, so everybody gets Aisha and tell her happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary. Right. Don't take it out.
Well, like Shannon said, I'm going to share my story, and it's my favorite thing to do, not because I'm filled with myself, but I'm very happy with what God has done in my life, and I love telling my story, because once you hear it, you know, it just proves that God can do the impossible, and He can do anything with anybody's life. So I will literally start at the beginning, and I'll just work my way through it. My name is Vincent Martin. I am 28 now. I was born in 1986 to Roberta Martin and Vincent Martin. That's my mother and my father. My life started off dramatic because I was born in the backseat of a car. You know, I couldn't even make it to the hospital. I was born in the backseat of a car. And my mother, when she had me, she was 21, and I was the youngest of 5 kids. So, you know, I have 3 older brothers and a sister. So by the time I was born, my mother was 21 when she had me. So me and my brother Chris, who we both have the same father, we were raised by my grandmother our whole life. We were raised by my grandmother. And the way our life was set up was during the school year, we would be with my grandmother, and we lived in a suburb of Dallas called W.O.W., predominantly white, really, really rich white people. And the other half of the year, so during breaks and summertime, we would go to my mother's house, and she always lived inner city. So South Garland, South Dallas, North Dallas, all those areas. So my life was like opposite ends of the spectrum. You know, I never could get settled. And then on top of that, my father was serving 25 year sentence for 2 counts of attempted capital murder against a law enforcement officer. So in between the trips to my mother's house for the summer breaks, and being in W.O.W. for the school year, we would make trips to, depending on where he was, you know, Tennessee Colony, Brownsville, Huntsville, State Penitentiary, once or twice a month. So my life was just a continual, you know, moving. I was always moving. Growing up, you know, I was a small guy. I'm not very big now. But if you can imagine, you know, growing up, I was very small. And when I was with the white kids, you know, I hope that doesn't offend anybody, but I say white and black when I tell myself. When I was with white kids, you know, I couldn't fit in because, you know, their parents were millionaires and they lived in mansions and, you know, and I was black, you know. But I got along with them enough. And then the black kids used to make fun of me because I was proper. You know, my grandmother bought us nice clothes. We had to tuck our shirts in. You know, when we came home every day, you take off your school clothes, you put on play clothes. That's how our clothes always looked nice. We didn't play them and stuff. So, you know, even though I got along with people, I never really fit in. So growing up, I tell people this all the time, I didn't even feel comfortable in my own skin. I had a lot of confidence. You know, whatever I wanted to do or tried to do, I was always good at it, but I didn't feel comfortable in my own skin. I didn't fit in with the black kids. I didn't fit in with the white kids. And that's hard. You know, in elementary school, I'm dealing with this. So, you know, but my grandmother raised me and my brother in the church. I mean, we grew up Pentecostal. We were in church like 8 days a week. Service was like, you know, 3 hours, and oh man, it was just, if I didn't know anything else, I knew God, you know, the Word of God. And so at an early age, that's what I was taught. I was taught faith, and I was taught that, you know, we're not going to be on earth forever, that eventually we're either going to go to heaven or hell. I had a decision to make. I remember being like 5 years old, and Pentecostal preachers used to scare the hell out of you, literally. You know, it would scare you out of hell. And so I remember being 5 years old, and the preacher like, you can't take anything with you whenever you go. And I had this Ninja Turtle, and I love this Ninja Turtle. If I died right now, I could take this Ninja Turtle, but that was my upbringing, you know? So I knew the church, but when the summertime came, you know, we moved right into poverty. And, you know, I had 5 brothers and sisters, 4 brothers and sisters plus me, and we always had like 4 or 5 relatives living with us. My mom's sister, her husband, another cousin. You know, so we'd be in like a 3-bedroom house with like 11 people, and only 2 people are working, there's only 1 source. And so, you know, we would get excited on the 1st and the 15th because that's when the food stamps came.
Right.
But, you know, on the 3rd and the 16th, we'd be starving again. And that's literally how it was. So at an early age, I learned how to just go and make it happen. You know, my old man, you know, he was locked up from the time he was 16 all the way up until he died in December. So he used to teach me like survival things, you know. He used to tell me, you know, hey, if there's somebody weaker, you know, you take advantage of them. If somebody's willing to give it to you, you take it. If a man's going to sell you his heart, you buy it, you know. So here I am, 5 and 6, I had this mentality, and then my mother, there would be nights where she'd be like, if y'all don't go get it, you're just not going to eat, you know. And so I would just go and get it. And God, you know, he gave me leadership. I was born with leadership. And before I knew how to use it for good, you know, I used it to survive. So I would get the kids in the neighborhood, and I could convince them to go and steal my family pork chops and ground meat and steak and hamburger helper. You know, so that's how we would eat most of the nights. And this is what I was doing at 5 and 6 years old. And then I would go back to Rockwall with all my Hasidic friends, and they would make fun of me and, you know, pick at me about, you know, being black or, you know, whatever. And the black kids would pick on me about being proper in my head. And I'm like, they have no idea. I just spent 4 months, you know, in South Dallas. They have no idea, you know, what I just did for 4 months. But God always gave me a spirit, you know, to not be a tyrant, even though I knew that's what I was capable of doing, even at 5 and 6. So my life continued at that pace until I was about 7 years old, you know, another 2 years. And I had this fear of staying at people's house, you know, because my grandmother, she didn't let us go spend the night at people's houses, because, you know, she was like, I don't know him, you know, I got to meet the parents and this and that. And she was very strict, but my mother was the exact opposite. You know, I could leave the house at 8 o'clock and come back at 10. You know, she, as long as I wasn't bleeding or missing anything, you know, she didn't question it. So when I was about 7 years old, I spent the night at my stepdad's mother's house, first time I ever spent the night somewhere. And they left us there, and it was me, my brother Chris, my sister, and then my second to the oldest brother. My oldest brother was locked up at the time. I was 7, so he was 14, down at Brownsville, which is a state penitentiary for boys in Texas. And he was like my hero. You know, I felt like nothing could happen to me if he was around. So this particular night, my stepdad's uncle was going through whatever he was going through that night. So it was him, and there was a woman who was paralyzed in a back room, and that was his grandmother. So this uncle comes in, and he's high, and he's drunk, and we're sitting in this room, and I remember, you know, this little room, and this light was hanging down over the table, and it was the only light in the room, and the living room was over here, and we hear the uncle, you know, he calls my sister's name first, and she goes over there, and it's just this awkward silence, because, you know, my brother doesn't know why he called her in there, I don't know, and Chris doesn't know, and then she came back about 3 minutes later, and she just crying, you know, tears are going down her face, and she didn't say anything, and we didn't ask. And, you know, my brother rolled the dice, and then he called my oldest brother in, and about 5 minutes later, he came back, and he was crying. And so then he was like, hey, let's just go to bed. And so we went to bed in this room. You know, if you cut this room in half, that's how big it was. You know, the bed was like this far from the wall on each side. And on each side of the room, there were doors. And there was one window behind me, and the porch light was coming through, and Bill had, the uncle had gone out there, and he was talking to a friend, and he was venting some of his frustrations. And then about 3 minutes later, you know, he came, and you hear him beating on this door. And then he stopped, and he came to this door, and he beat on this door, and I just remember being terrified. You know, I didn't even pray for God. I didn't even pray for my dad. I just prayed that my oldest brother would be there, because I was deathly afraid. You know, we didn't have cell phones back then, and the nearest phone was in the room with a paralyzed old lady. So, you know, what hope did we really have? And I don't remember exactly what happened, but Bill went out to the porch, so then we ran to the room and we called my stepdad. And, you know, it was probably a 30-minute drive, but he had to have made it there in 15 minutes. And he came, and I remember him, he had this Monte Carlo, and he pulled up, and I went running outside. And what had happened was he raped my sister and my brother. So, you know, if I was 7, my sister was 10, and my brother was 12, you know, he had raped them, and we didn't know it at the time. We just know we were deathly afraid. And so I go running out there to my stepdad, and Bill's like, hey, nephew. And then my stepdad beats him up. You know, I'm 7 years old, and you know, I don't know if you've ever seen a man get his head kicked in, but at 7 years old, that's traumatizing. And then to find out what had actually happened, you know. But one thing that I learned in that situation when I went back home at the end of the summer is like, maybe God does protect people. You know, because he never called me, he never called my brother, my other brother, you know, never understood it to this day. You know, I still struggle with that. And so, you know, I kept it all inside, and I kept going, I kept growing. And so, you know, my life was still, you know, teeter-totter, go to the prison, visit with my dad for 2.5 hours, and then come home, and that was my life. And then, you know, I got to middle school. You know, I was a straight-A student. I excelled at everything that I did. And the summer going into my sixth grade year, my grandmother remarried. And I wasn't used to that. I was used to just being my grandmother, me, and Chris. And so then she remarried a man from the church, and I mean, bless his soul, he wasn't made to deal with kids. So we came home at the end of the summer, getting ready for my seventh grade year, and I was very excited because if there was one thing I was good at, it was football. You know, I was above nothing, but I was good at football. And the very first time I went to football practice, I sat in a pile of fire ants, Texas fire ants, and I was allergic to ants. So I ended up swelling like 13 pounds of swelling. But 2 weeks later, I was right back at practice. And I just loved it. Everywhere I went, if I could play with the big kids, I played, you know. So this seventh grade year, I'm getting ready to play my first middle school game. And my brother Chris, you know, he's a trip. I mean, he's a man of God now, but back then, this kid was something else. So, you know, he had a smart mouth, but my grandmother used to deal with him in a certain way. But this man didn't like that. He didn't like how she dealt with it. He didn't like how he talked to her. So he came back there and he got my brother's face. And back then, my brother, you know, he was like 0 to 100 right now. And so this man gets in his face and Chris gets back in his face and he punches my brother. And one thing about me and Chris, have you ever met, or maybe you have a brother or sister, like when they got a whooping, you cried even if you weren't getting a whooping? I'm like, that's how it was. And so when he punched Chris, you know, in my head, I thought about everything my dad had ever told me about prison. And everything he had ever told me about protecting and being loyal. And so, you know, here I am in the seventh grade, and this man punches my brother in the face, and I'm thinking, I'm gonna kill him. You know, I'm in the seventh grade, and I'm like, he has to die. He cannot make it out of here alive. So I run to the garage, and I grab a shovel, and I come back, and my grandmother, you know, is just like, no, that's not how it's gonna go down. And so I'm holding the shovel, and then this man takes a cane, and he hits my brother right in the forehead. And it just hurt me so bad. So then I was angry at her, you know, and the situation went on. And that exact night, we moved out of the house with my grandmother and in with my aunt. And so in the seventh grade before my first football game, I'm like, how is this fair? You know, my mother had me, I'm the fifth of, you know, five kids. She was 21. I had to live with my grandmother. I would love to be with my mother. My dad is in prison. And my grandmother, you know, she gave us a life and I was getting used to it, but now we have to live with my aunt. Why do we have to leave, you know? So I made it my point in life to do whatever I wanted to do. And I didn't care who had to deal with it. So I went from being an A student to, in the seventh grade, I failed everything. Everything. They wouldn't even put my grade on report cards. You know, my grandmother would just have to come in and talk to the principal, like, we just don't understand. You know, I did everything. 2 weeks after Columbine, I brought a gun to school. You know, and in my middle school, there was probably 1,500 kids, and 20 of us were black. So a black kid bringing a gun to school 2 weeks after Columbine, you know, it wasn't the best idea. So then I got put in alternative school, which made me have an even harder shell because I was a little guy, and people would try to pick on me, and I'm not bragging on myself. I've never lost a fight. And there's never been a fight that I got into that I didn't come out on top. So, you know, the big kids would pick on me, and, you know, my dad used to teach me things. If they're bigger than you, then there's no weapon too big that you can't use. So, you know, Nick Larson, I remember like it was yesterday, he pulled my shirt in the middle of class, and I had a pencil in my hand. I just turned around and stabbed him in the arm, and then I had a science book, and I hit him in the head, and then they were just like, hey, this kid can't be in the school district anymore. You know? But my grandmother was a praying woman, and to this day, I don't know how it worked out, but we got back into the school. And so, you know, I got a second chance at an early age. So in the eighth grade, I'm playing football again, and I had this little fat round coach. His name was Coach Henderson. And he was just a little fat round guy. That's how I remember. He was short and fat round. And he was, you know, in Texas, they have those real heavy accents and they chew tobacco, you know. And he saw me run and he pulled me to the side and he said, boy, you are faster than a hiccup. And I didn't know what that meant at the time. And he was like, you're gonna play running back. So I played running back, and then that's when I truly fell in love with the game, because in Texas, football is huge. So at middle school games, I was playing in front of like 500, 600 people. And that was just my road. After that, I took off. I was good after that. You know, my grades were back on track. I was focused again. And I went to Rockwell High School, which is a big 5A school. And, you know, we had the best of everything. Under Armour, you know, pet buses. When we played our rival, we had police escorts, and we were followed by like 60 cars, and there would be 20 or 30,000 people at the game. So I was on this great stage. I was in a great space, and you know, I wrestled. I was good at that. And I was a power lifter. I was good at that. I ran track. I was good at that. You know, just everything I put my hands to, I was successful at, you know, but the thing I could not beat was every summer. You know, I would build my life up during the school year, and then every summer I would go to poverty. And it just didn't make sense, you know? I would get there and I would lose all motivation. You know, I had to go back to fending for myself. I wasn't working out and keeping up with my competition, you know? So one summer, I earned the starting position. I was a sophomore, earned the starting position. I'm a running back, 125 pounds in Texas, running the wing tee. Okay, so in the wing tee, I was the lead blocker on the linebacker, you know, so I'm lining up against guys that were 225 pounds and lead blocking, and I earned a starting position. So all I had to do was work out and come back, you know, and I would have been a starter. But my sister had her own apartment, and so I went to Dallas for the summer, and I turned into an absolute tyrant. Everything that I knew I was on the inside, everything my dad had taught me, you know, because that's all I knew. That's all I was surrounded by. And I had to survive. I couldn't go out there and be like, I'm going in to work on some geometry, or I'm about to go run some stairs and condition. People didn't understand that. You know, I was surrounded by Bloods and Crips and folks and everything else. So what I did, I took the hardest guy from each gang in that part of Dallas. I had a Crip friend, I had a Blood friend, I had a folks friend. We came together and we came up with the color changing clique. That's what I called us, because we were made up of different gang members. And we terrorized North Dallas, and that's what I did. And I remember one night, I was walking back from a house party all by myself, though to this day, I don't know why. And I was in this alley, and this guy, you know, he called me out, and it was him and four of his friends. And he was like, you know, you can say what you want to, but you ain't leaving until you scrap all of us. And I was like, well, as long as I don't scrap all four of y'all, you know, we can do this. So no lie, man, for like 25 minutes, I just went toe-to-toe with four dudes, you know. I'd fight one for like 2 or 3 minutes, and then another one would come. You know, and they were fair with me. You know, they didn't jump on me when I was down. They let me get back up. And, you know, after that, I just became real, like, my mind was, I don't know, but now that I know the word, and I know how God works, I know how the enemy works, I was just overcome by the enemy. And I was just bloodthirsty. And at that point, I began to not mind seeing people hurt. Because back in the day, you know, when I was younger, it used to hurt my feelings when people would hurt, when people would cry. But after that, like, I didn't care. Because I realized it's a hard world out there. And so, you know, my life kept going. I went back to Rockwall, and I lost my starting position, and I got into some trouble. But then I got a second chance, again. And I went from this big old school, you know, with 4,500 kids from 10th to 12th grade, and I came to school just like Word of Life. And I got a second chance, and I did amazing things. You know, I had the Texas State record for most touchdowns in the season, most kickoff returns in the season. I had a game with 8 carries, 185 yards, 5 offensive touchdowns, and a defensive touchdown. You know, I got to get back where God had put me before I started making mistakes. And so my senior year, I was here, and I was like, you know what, God, I figured it out. If I give you all the glory, I give you all the honor like I was taught, then you'll take care of the rest. If I just let you do this thing, you will take care of the rest. And exactly that happened. You know, I remember going to college trips and offers and getting college letters, and Dallas Morning News would call me every Friday morning and interview me before games. And I was just living the life. And I made my decision out of all the colleges. I don't know why, but I picked Tabor College in Hillsboro, Kansas. Don't know why. Obviously, I was inspired by God. But I did. I chose it, and I was excited about it. And I finally got a ticket. I was the first person in my family, besides my grandmother, to go to college. And I was only the third person in my family to graduate from high school. And I'm talking about generations and generations and generations, the third person. And so, you know, when I left for college, I was like, man, I'm going to do this. I made my mind up, and nothing was going to steer me any different. Well, my first 3 weeks in college, nobody told me that football was so serious. So, you know, you wake up in the morning, you go to practice, you eat breakfast, film. You go to practice, film, eat lunch. Go to practice, eat dinner, film, go to sleep, wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, do it all over again. My tonsils swole up, my head, you know, I called my grandma, I don't even care about playing football, I just want to come home. But she's like, no, you have to persevere. She gave me some scriptures, and I hung up the phone just so I didn't have to hear it anymore. But I stuck with it. And a team who had never even had a winning season. We went undefeated my first year. We won a conference championship. I got honor on top of honor. I was an academic All-American. I mean, God had just done some amazing things with my life. So I was on the right track. I was a pre-med psychology student. And I just knew I was going to be a doctor. I was going to move my mother out of the hood, you know. My dad used to always say that when he finally got out, he wanted this house on the lake, and I was going to provide that. But then I met a girl my sophomore year in college. And when you're in college, you know, you're broke, and you really don't have a source. Well, this girl was my source. Like, she didn't mind spending money. And I would be lying if I said that I wasn't attracted to her and I didn't have feelings for her, but there was a large percentage of it that had to do with the fact that if I wanted food at 12 o'clock at night, she would drive from Wichita and bring me Kentucky Fried Chicken, and she would buy it for all my boys in the quad, you know? And so, you know, I would get out of practice and there would be boxes of shoes in my room, you know? And I liked that, you know? I was fresh in college, and I was a man, and I was smart, and I was getting grades, and everybody was happy. Well, then I had to make a decision at the end of my sophomore year. Was I going to go home, or was I going to stay with this girl? And I made the very smart decision to stay with this girl, and I'm being sarcastic, because it was probably the worst decision I had made in my teenage life. I never thought that I could have been mentally abused, you know? Like, this person, man, she made me feel like dirt, constantly, made me feel like dirt. To the point that where she told me, she's like, I mean, you're a good-looking guy, but that's all you have going for you. You know, and that these are the kind of things that she used to tell me. And I was away from my family, and my mother would worry about me. And one time she broke my cell phone, and I didn't have a way to talk to anybody. So then my brothers came up and got me, and they brought me back home, and I stayed home for 2 weeks, and she convinced me to come back. You know, I was like a battered woman. You know, you hear about women being in these situations. But, you know, here I was, this big football star, and, you know, muscle man, and I mean, I don't look like it now. I was like 185 pounds. And you know, I didn't think that anybody could have that hold on me. But you know, one thing that I got away from, I got prideful. I was filled with myself. My ego was like this big, and I got away from God. I got away from prayer. I got away from reading my word. So you know, I always compared this part of my life to judges. You know, God would save them. They would do good for a little while, and then they would fall back down, and they would pray and beg God. You know, and it was a cycle. So at the end of my sophomore year, as mentally abused as I was, you know, I made the decision not to go back to college. You know, I was a two-time all-conference. You know, I had all these things going for me. The team was winning. And I remember the first day of school, and the coaches were calling my phone and, hey, you know, where are you? And they would write me on MySpace at that time. My teammates would write me. I wasn't answering phone calls. They come and knock at the door. I wouldn't answer. I remember crying my eyes out, just looking through the blinds, like seeing my coach, you know, and he's making every effort. And to this day, I couldn't tell you why I didn't go back, you know. And for a long time, that haunted me because I was in a good position. You know, I could have done some amazing things with my life, whether it had been with sports or with academics. So, you know, I stayed with this girl, and it was like pure punishment. And I don't say this to make her sound like a monster, you know, but that's really what it was. My life, I just hated it. I hated everything about it. So now I'm slipping back into what I used to be when I was like 7, 8, 9, 10, and then my teenage years. You know, I just turned into a tyrant. My heart was cold. I didn't care, you know. And then to speed the story up, this girl ends up getting pregnant. You know, she it was her house, it was her money, it was her everything. And 2 weeks before I found out she was pregnant, she kicks me out. So I'm living in a Regency Inn on West Kellogg, you know, which is like a roach motel. It's like the worst of the worst. I don't know what I was thinking there. But I'm standing there, and she calls me one morning, and she's like, you have to come home. And I'm thinking, you know, maybe it was her crazy baby daddy that was scaring her. I was like, oh, you know, when you kicked me out, you lost all those benefits. She's like, no, I'm pregnant. And one thing about me, I made up my mind when I was like 4 years old. Me and my brother used to talk, like my grandmother would make us go to bed. You know, talking. It's like, man, when I get old, my kids are gonna play with your kids. We're gonna be the best dads and everything else. We just made our mind up that when the opportunity came, we were gonna make the most of it. And as much as she beat me down and I didn't have much feelings for her, I was like, okay. So I moved back in with her, and I had a really good job working at the JDF. I'm making like $16 an hour, and I'm a 21-year juvenile detention facility. And making really good money, and we moved back in with each other. And then she got to being herself again. And at 7 months pregnant, I remember it like it was yesterday, she used to just push my buttons, you know? And I, one thing about me, I'm honest with people. I'll tell them, hey, don't push my buttons because I will punch you in the nose. You know, I'm not lying about that. If I tell you, hey, I will hurt you, I'm going to hurt you. And so I used to tell her, like, listen, could you please not push my buttons because I know you're doing it on purpose. And so she had a son by somebody else at that time, and he came up to me, and I wasn't having a good day, and he was saying something, and I didn't laugh at his joke. And she said, you know, you piece of, why don't you laugh at this joke? You're going to give my son, you're going to mess his head up. And I lost it. I did not put a hand on her because she was pregnant, she was carrying my daughter, but I tore up everything in the house. And I mean, when I say I had a fit, I mean, to where while I was going through it, I didn't even recognize myself, you know? I started punching out windows and I was angry, and really what it was just frustration with life. You know, being an all-star running back and being the man and an academic All-American to like just working at JDF, and I wasn't happy with the person I was with. And so she grabs her son, and her father was, her grandfather was a retired officer, so everybody knew him. So, you know, I'm sitting down, I'm gathering my breath, and I call my grandmother, and I hear a knock at the door. And I go and answer the door, no lie, there was like 14 cops at the front door, and they all have their guns drawn. And I'm on the phone with my grandmother. They say, get off the phone. I said, you knocked on my door, and I'm inside my house. I'm not getting off the phone. And at that time, I heard them cop the guns, take the safety off, and so I told my grandmother, hey, I'm gonna call you. And so, basically, I had to make a decision right then. And we separated, and I started my own path. And I meant to pass these out at the beginning, but I'm passing out now. I started my own path. I got my own place, I had my own job. And I had a daughter on the way, and I was like, I'm going to be a provider. So I used to go to work every day. And then my daughter was born. And then I realized babies are expensive. You know, and you can't have, you can't take care of a baby on a $9 an hour job. I ended up losing my job at the JDF. Long story. And I lost my job at JDF, so now I'm working at Champs. And I have my oldest brother, you know, he came to me and he's like, if you need extra money, man, I can help you out, okay? And I was like, well, what do you mean? He was like, I can get you some counterfeit money. He's like, for, you know, every $1,000 in counterfeit money, you give me $450 real money, I'll get you $1,000 in counterfeit money. I was like, bet, you know, that's nothing to argue about. He was getting away with it, you know? So he used to bring me money, I'd give him $450, he'd give me $1,000, and I'd go about my life. But then I started doing really stupid stuff, and I started mixing the counterfeit money with company money because I had earned a management position. I'm not gonna say the company because I'm being recorded. Who knows the company? But you know, I was just ruthless. And then when I worked at the JDF, this is the first time I've ever been honest with anybody about this at this group. There was a young man there, and let's call him Bob, okay? So Bob was an inmate there. He was like 17 years old, and I'm a corrections worker. But there was something about this guy, man, I don't know what it was, but I used to just get along with him. Even though he was younger than me, he was one of my inmates, I used to get along with him. You know, I would bring him food in, you know, like Wendy's and stuff. Don't know why, but I used to. I don't know if I felt like he was a little brother or what. But, you know, while I was out and I got into this illegal activity and I wasn't making enough money, I came across him in the streets. And I told him what I was doing. He's like, man, you gonna make some real money? And I was like, yeah. He was like, come with me. So he takes me to South Broadway, okay? So I'm sitting in a crack house on South Broadway, and at this time, I'm still kind of like a square, you know? I'm still real proper, and I don't really know the streets. Like, I know I'm on the inside, but on the outside, you wouldn't be able to tell, like, kind of like I am now. And so, you know, I start sitting in the crack house, and then finally, he was like, listen, you buy a team, you know, which is just a little bit of crap. He's like, you break it down, you sell it, and then you double up, and you keep going. So I'm like, all right. So then I started sitting in the crack house, you know, and, you know, one day I'd make $100, and then the next day, you know, I'd make an extra $100, and I was building them up. Then I got to a point where I was making, like, $1,000 a week. Then I was making $2,000 a week, and I was like, man, selling dope ain't all that bad. You know what I'm saying? Even, you know, I could buy my baby mama off, you know? And when she gets the busted, I can give her $1,000, she'll shut up. You know, so I was like, okay, money is good. I can take care of my daughter. So then when I say I got into the lifestyle, I was on South Broadway. I mean, what else can I say about that? I was in the Bellboy Hotel. I was in the Otto. I was in, God, what are some more of those hotels down there? I was in all of them, from all on the South Side, the South Broadway, which is a gross place, nasty place. And it's not the people, it's, you know, the enemy working through those people, man. And I just keep women with rape coming there pregnant, you know, 8 months pregnant, you know, buying crack. Or come in with their 9-year-old daughter trying to sell their daughters for crack. Or a man will come in and sell his husband, I mean, a man will come in and sell his wife for crack, and she absolutely didn't want nothing to do with it. And I was seeing men, you know, other, you know, clean-cut women, very good-looking women that had no business being there, you know, and the husbands are selling them to crackheads for $10 hits. You know, and these women are crying. And in my head, I didn't have enough guts on the inside of me to stand up for that, you know? And so I would just deal with it. And then I got deeper into the game, and I started learning about sex trafficking. And, you know, I was dealing with a guy who was selling me, he was my supplier, right? But really, he was cheating me. So I would go in and buy like an 8-ball of crack or a half an ounce of crack, but he was shorting me, you know, grams here and there. So this is when the Asians were really big in, God, what is that little community in
Plainview?
Plainview. They were really big in Plainview.
Don't ask me how I know.
Yeah, they were really big in Plainview, and ecstasy was on the move, and sex trafficking was on the move, you know? And so they were like, we need an ounce of crack. So I'm like, all right, I'll go to my supplier because I trust him to give me an ounce of crack. And this man gives me a half an ounce of crack. You know, I didn't weigh it up. So, you know, I knock on this door, somebody opens this little thing, and they let me in, they pat me down. And then I go through another room that's just filled with TVs because they have cameras everywhere. Then I walk through another room where, you know, girls from 8 years old to grown women were tied up on beds, you know, and I mean, there was pee everywhere and poop and tampons. Like, it was just disgusting. And I walked through that room, and then I went to another room, and, you know, here, a room full of angry Asians holding AKs and pistols. And, you know, I give him the crack because I think it's legit. And he puts it on the scale, and he's like, man, what are you trying to do? And I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, man, this ain't a whole ounce. This is a half an ounce of crack. He's like, do I look like an idiot? So here I am, and there's no way out. There's no way out, you know? So he's like, listen, this is what you're going to do. Whoever, because I explained to him, I was like, listen, man, I'm just a little man. And he could probably tell, you know, I was a square at that time. He's like, listen, you're going to go back, and you're going to get the rest of my crack. Okay, he's like, and if you don't, you're going to pay the price for it. So he puts one of his people in the car with me with a gun in the back seat, and I go back to his house. I'm like, I need another ounce of crack. He's like, half an ounce of crack. He's like, man, I gave you an ounce. I'm like, brother, listen, you did not. And somebody's going to kill me if you don't give me the rest of this crack. And so he didn't give me the crack. So I snuck out the back door, and that was the first time I started living my life on the run. So now the angry Asians are after me. And then I met another guy who was a blood, and you know, he was an OG, this dude was known. And he kind of took me up under his wing. And the young man that was my inmate that I was selling dope with got envious of that. He got jealous of that because I started making more money with him. So one night he sent an addict in, and she came to buy crack from him. Really, she was telling him where I was sitting in the house. And so she left, and about a minute later, there was a gunshot. Bam, you know, and I'm sitting at this window, and everybody's eyes just gets this big. And I'm sitting there looking at everybody like, what is the problem? They're like, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, I'm okay. And they start touching my head, and you know, I'm a germaphobe, you know, and a bunch of addicts are touching my head. So I'm like, what are you doing? It's like, and I turned around, and the whole window was shattered out, and there was a bullet on the ground, 45 caliber bullet. And, you know, this wasn't a special window, you know? I'm on South Broadway, ain't nothing special about those windows. But the bullet didn't hit me in the head. It was exactly where it needed to be. It didn't pass me, you know? And I found out later on that this guy was approximately 6 feet from the window when he shot. And so, you know, I left that place that night, and that's when I started praying. This first time, whenever my life took this drastic turn, I actually started praying again. I'm like, God, where am I at? How did I end up here? I don't even recognize this place. You know, my grandmother would call me. I'd ignore her phone calls. I wasn't talking to anybody, man. My best friends were crack addicts and murderers and dope dealers. And, you know, I have a million stories. a million stories. I can tell you stories for night, all night. You know, the first time I ever got robbed, you know, I'm talking to this guy, and he seems real friendly, you know, and I fall asleep, which I finally, I learned, you don't fall asleep in the trap house. You know, you never fall asleep in the trap house. I wake up to a 250-pound man on my chest with a knife to my eye. And I remember this night perfectly because it was the first blizzard that I had ever been in. And this was 2007. So that first big blizzard that came through Wichita in 2007, and he had opened the door because he had planned on robbing me and then running out the door. And I had a pistol, but it was under the seat that I was laying on top of. So he said, they called me Texas. He said, Texas, all the money is in the right pocket. I need it. Don't move fast. I'm going to put this knife in your eye. And I didn't even know what to say. And there was this lady there, and she jumped up. She said, oh, my God. And he stabbed her. And I'm seeing blood squirt everywhere. She's screaming. Everybody's coming out of the room. And now he's pressing this knife to my eye. And I'm just frozen with fear. And I'm like, I don't even want to get the money. So I just tell him, go get it, you know? But I said in my mind, remember earlier in the story when the guy hit my brother? You know, I was like, I'm going to kill him. If I get the opportunity, I'm going to kill him. I said, when he gets off of me, I'm going to get this pistol, and I'm going to put every bullet that's in this clip in him. So he gets up, and he runs through the door, right? And remember, it was a blizzard, so he slips. Bam, and he falls on the ground. So I'm grabbing the pistol, and I get it, and I take the safety off, and I cock it, and I close the door, and he was gone. And so this woman is bleeding to death on the floor, and it's a blizzard, and I'm like, I can't call the cops because this is a crack house. So I put her in my car, and I take her to St. Francis, and I drop her off. And I call my boy, and I say, hey, I got robbed, and we got to go get this back. So we actually used that guy's little cousin to set him up. And so the little cousin is in the back seat, you know, he has his gun, and we're driving there. And the little cousin starts to figure out, like, hold on, man. This is my cousin we're going to rob. And he's like, I'm not cool with this. And my right-hand man was like, man, you shut up. You know, we're going to get there and we're going to do this. He's like, no, I'm not cool with this. Cocks the gun, and he's sitting right behind me, puts the gun to the back of my car seat while I'm driving. He said, if this car moves another inch, I'm going to blow his brains out. And so, luckily, we were at a stoplight. You know, and so my boy was like, man, put the gun down. He's like, no, I'm going to do it. He said, man, put the gun down. So he talks the guy into the gun, guy gets on the gun, and we go to these apartments to still take care of this business. And we get there, and I remember being terrified, you know. I tell a lot of kids all the time, you know, you hear about robbing and killing all this stuff. What those guys don't tell you is how terrified they are while they're doing it. I've never met a man that was just a stone cold killer. Never. They always shake a little bit, they're always scared a little bit. So I'm frightened. And he goes up and he robs him, and he's like, you just wait in the car. And he comes back downstairs, and he's running, and two guys are running after him with guns. And so, you know, this guy was my right-hand man. Like, I would die for him. So he's running, and I just did what I thought was right. I just started shooting back, you know. So here we are at Lincoln and Oliver just having a shootout. You know, what am I thinking? Just having a shootout at Lincoln and Oliver. And so he gets in the car, and this is my right-hand man, my loyal guy, and he's crying. He's scared. And he doesn't want to shoot his gun. And so, you know, a brand new coldness came over me, you know, and we made it out of that situation. And I was like, man, I don't care how many people are with me, man, I'm always by myself. I'm always going to be just worried about me because you can't depend on nobody else. You know, this is the OG Bloods, and he's teaching me the game. He's over here crying while I'm saving his life. And so, man, after that, my life was, as if it wasn't bad enough, I got into drugs. You know, I was smoking about an ounce of weed a day. Ecstasy was my drug of choice. I would take like 8 to 10 pills a day. I'd take them two at a time, 8 to 10 pills. And that was on Monday through Thursday. Whenever I was in the club, I would take like 14 to 16 pills in a day. So Saturday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So, you know, my mouth hurt, my teeth hurt. I would bite my tongue, you know, from all the side effects. I wouldn't sleep for weeks. I would hallucinate, you know, and I was just a wrecking ball. You know, I became violent. You know, a person who couldn't hurt people, I began to just do things. So over $50, I kicked the door in. You know, one time I kicked the door in and there was like 6 kids on the floor. And you know, I jumped over them and I ran past this bathroom and this wife was putting her hair up and I went to the back door of the room and I kicked the door open and the husband is who I was looking for. So we grabbed them and we're dragging them out. Kids are on my legs. you know, and the wife comes out, my boy punches the wife in the face, and we're getting kicked, and this is over $50. And then we beat him up in the front yard, we didn't even get no money out of it. You know, but that's where I was in my mind. And I made up my mind that, you know, from now on, I don't care what anybody says, it's doggy dog. You know, and I told my boy, let's become millionaires at selling dope. He was like, if you want to be a millionaire selling dope, you gotta be willing to kill. And I'm like, I'm willing to do that. That's not a problem. So the guy who tried to kill me, you know, he was like, this is gonna be the first test. This is what we're gonna do. He was at the auto, you know. So we had this girl go in. We're like, you'll put some Visine in his drink, okay? When he falls asleep, hit us up. We're gonna come in. We're gonna rob him. We're gonna kill him. So we're sitting across from his room. I had a Cutlass, an 86 Cutlass. It was nice. Yeah, had 215s in the back, MTX 9500s, had some screens, everything. So we're sitting there and we're just smoking blunt after blunt. And I've already taken my drink, I've already popped my pills, and I'm just out of my mind, you know? And he's like, all right, now if he stands up, you shoot him. If he does this, you shoot him. If he does this, I'll shoot him, you know, whatever. He's like, well, do you want to see him suffer? You know, we were planning out this man's murder, you know? How do we want to kill him? And I heard God's voice. You know, clear as day. And it scared the heck out of me. He said, this ain't my plan for you. 2 seconds later, about 10 cop cars come into the parking lot. And so I'm like, oh man, this girl has snitched us out. They get out the cop car, run to the guy's room that we were gonna go kill and arrest him. Come to find out, he had escaped from JDF and he had beat up 2 corrections officers and they were coming to get him. The guy that I had made my mind up I was gonna kill, the cops came and got him. So then I got back in the church, you know, because that was just too much for me. But my lifestyle was still hectic. No lie, you know, I used to pay tithes on my drug money. You know, I was putting $1,600 in. I used to pay tithes, you know, I would save money, I give my 10%. You know, no lie, I commit a robbery, stay up all night, but I was in church. I would take a bath. I was, you know, I was making sure I was shaved up and I had long dreadlocks. I tied them up, I put on a suit top, and I would go sit in church. Sometimes I would still be hot from the night before, you know? But I knew that I had to be where God could talk to me, you know? And I knew he could talk to me in the dope house, but I had to be in his presence. And so, you know, my life just kept getting hectic. And I was cocky, the cops hated me. I mean, I was arrested for everything. Assault on a law enforcement officer, evading arrest, possession with intent, you know. But my life finally came to a boiling point when we had a trap house that was about 500 feet from a school. Which, you know, if you have drugs and guns within 1,000 feet of a school, that's an automatic felony. So my house gets raided, and you know, I remember like it was yesterday. I had my trap house, and then I had a nice house across the street. And my nice house had all the nice stuff, and that's where I would eat and I would sleep. It was one of my houses, you know. I had a couple of dope houses, some over on Lincoln and Oliver, and I had some in South Broadway. Believe it or not, you know, we had a house in Eastboro, you know, and we would party and sell dope there, you know. And then I had my getaway apartment was at Cross Creek at 32nd and Rock. So, you know, I would stay at this house across the street from my trap house because where the money was going, you know, like you didn't let the money sit in the trap house because when people know that you're making $10,000 and $12,000 a day, you're going to get robbed. So as soon as the money was made, I would come and get it, and I would take it, and I would stash it at one of my houses. So this guy that's working for me said, hey, nephew, the money is made. So I came across the street. Beautiful day in the middle of the summer, you know? It's like 75 degrees. It was abnormally nice. You know, the birds were chirping. I just remember this. And so I come in, and he says, nephew, the rest of the crack is in the ceiling fan. He's like, but I got to go home. I got to sleep. I said, okay. He gives me the money, and I hear what sounds like the front of my house being hit by a diesel truck. So I'm like, what is that, huh? And we look down this hallway together, and there it is, the whole sheriff's department. They got their shields, they got their AKs and their lasers. People start coming through windows, you know, and they come in, and sure enough, the guy that I punched in the face 2 weeks earlier was the first one through, and he has this shield, and you know, he's probably 200 pounds plus, and I'm 125 pounds because I've been popping pills and not eating. And man, he hit me so hard that he knocked me into this wall and my whole body, you know, left a hole in the wall. And he gets down on me and he punches me in the back of the head, he puts his knee in my back and they cuff me. And you know, the whole time I'm running my mouth because I know they ain't gonna find the dope. You know, the canines can pick up stuff on the ground within the ceiling fan. I'm like, officer, what are you doing? You know, and he's like, oh, this is a lot of money. I'm like, yeah, I went to the casino last night. You know, and he said something. And I told him, I'll put your daughter through college or something like that, I said. So, you know, they take me out in front of the whole neighborhood. They take me to jail, and I get out, you know, because they didn't find anything. And cocky me, I go get dope and go right back to the dope spot. And as I'm pulling up, an officer comes up and gets me out. And to this day, I don't know why I didn't run, you know. He said, Texas, why didn't you run? I said, I don't know. I had half an ounce of crack in my pocket, had about $600 in my other pocket. I had a pistol that was fully loaded, one in the chamber. I had a well-known gang member in me, in the car with me that had a pistol also and crack. And so I went to jail, to say the least, again, this the next day. So they take me down to the south, you know, hub or whatever that is. And they put me in this room and they chained me to this chair to where I couldn't lean far enough this way to rest on the wall. You know, I couldn't lean this way because that was uncomfortable. There was no wall behind me. And it's like 20 degrees in this room. All I got is a shirt on, you know, and they come back everyone's probably like, so who's your supplier, you know? And my dad always told me, you know, a snitch. There's no protection for a snitch. I said, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm a student, you know? And then they came back and they showed me my dad's arrest history, you know? Now the feds are in there. They're like, we know your dad. We know he's the leader of this. We know he's that. We know he killed cops and all this stuff. So I don't know what you're talking about. So then they put me in the car. I said, take me to booking, you know? Because I had a bail bondsman who I could just call up. You know, he's going to meet me in booking. Bail bondsmen don't get to come into booking. You know, he's going to be in booking. Whenever I make it to booking and they pat me down and they strip search me, by the time I step in there, he's going to be right there like, come on, let him out. Every time I went to jail, I said, get me the booking. I'll be out in 5 minutes. So I get the booking. They call me Big Bang Hank at the county. If you look at that picture right there, that was the picture of the arrest that day. Notice I don't have a shirt on again. Okay, they beat me out of my shirt. No lie. I'm not lying. I'm not saying that so people think cops are bad people, you know, because there are some good cops. But these cops beat the mess out of me. So, you know, I'm in there, I'm like, whatever, you know, my bail bondsman's gonna be here. They're going through my fingerprints, okay, if you've ever been to the county, you know, I knew the whole process. You know, you want my thumb next? You know, hurry up. So I'm ready to go home, I'm hungry. And I would always look over at my sheet while they're doing my fingerprints, and I would look at what my bail bond, you know, was. And so I looked over, and it said, all my charges and the amount was zero, which means I didn't have a bond. I wasn't getting out. And so, you know, all the officers were laughing because every time I would come in there, you know, I would give them hell, you know? And then, so they put me in the detox room with this guy who was detoxing from heroin. Pee everywhere, poop everywhere, and he was a racist. Okay, and the detox room is really a one-man room, but I'm in there with this guy, you know, and when he would wake up and he could recognize who he was, he'd come swinging at me, you know, and so I was having to defend myself, and I'm slipping and peeing and poop, and I was just angry, and I was just like, yes.
The youth, we're going to have a car wash on Sunday, so you can bring your car over, and during service, we'll clean it, and it's donation, so you can get whatever you feel like giving. So, yeah, we'll wash it. It's for Youth America, so you can.
Thank you.
It's during service. Yes, yeah.
So you guys aren't going to be at church?
Technically no, but we're still in the building.
That's
all
that matters. Okay, check it. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, you know, I'm in there and I finally, they brought me out after laughing and everything. They showered me up. They gave me my jumpsuit. I never had a jumpsuit, you know, because every time I would come to booking, I'd be out. You know, I never got to sit in a cell. And so, you know, this is when I was broken the most. And one thing my grandmother used to always tell me is like, when you're broken the most, that's when you can hear God the most. You can hear him, it's clear. You can pray to him, you can come to him, you can humble yourself. So I'm sitting in there and I'm like, whatever you have for me, you can do it. Whether I go upstairs, I go to the state penitentiary, whatever it is, Lord, you can do whatever you want to with my life. And I laid down and I slept like a baby, okay? Woke up the next morning, they're like, Martin, come on. So I grabbed my stuff, and they're like, no, leave that there. And they're like, you're leaving. I didn't have a bond, I didn't have a bail, you know? I'm like, well, nobody can pay 10% of nothing, so how am I getting out, you know? And I don't know, you know, I don't know how you get out, but you want to go? And I'm like, yeah. So I didn't have my cell phone because the cops broke it that day when I went and snitched. So I had this long walk home back to one of my dope spots from 205 North Main, which is the county. So I'm walking down the street, no shoes, no shirt, and I'm just like, God, is this you? And I begin to pray, and I'm like, whatever you have for me, I'll do it. I'll do it. I'll submit everything I know, everything. So I finally made it back to my car, and of course I needed clothes. So the first place I went to was the mall, Dillard's, okay? And that's where I met my wife. And that day, I got out of jail, and I went straight to the mall, and I met her, and I annoyed her really bad because it was closing time, and I couldn't make my mind up on an outfit, which now she knows that's just how I am. So, you know, and after I met her, you know, and I sat in my car, and I was like, I should probably, you know, ask her to lunch or something. But I was used to dealing with girls that just wanted me because of my money. You know, I had 4 or 5 cars, 4 or 5 houses. You know, I forgot how to be a gentleman. So, you know, here I come, you know, I'm smelling like weed and I got these dreadlocks and everything. And I was like, can I take you to lunch? And she was like, yes, I took her to Carlos O'Kelly's, you know, like a 5-star lunch. And we've been together ever since. I told people, you know, like I put a post up today and I was like, you know, we've been together since day one, literally. Since the day we met each other, we have been together. There's never been a day that we were not together. And that's when God elevated my life. And he took me from this violent, drug addict, you know, person that I didn't even know to where I am now. You know, and I, down the line, if you look at this picture, you know, we got our life straight. We got about 2.5 years into having my life straight. They served me with a subpoena, you know, and they brought up all my charges. And I got a lawyer, where I have a public defender, which I wouldn't advise anybody doing, because he really didn't care.
He's like, amen.
Yeah. He's like, just take a felony. And I'm like, no, man, you know what? Because I felt like I could still get my life together. You know, I was like, well, what am I going to do with a degree and a felony? So I get this lawyer, and long story short, I still got convicted. But my lawyer was able, because I was a first-time convicted offender, he said, you know, they gave me a year of probation with a 10-year underlying sentence, which means I could have violated on day 365 and I was going to have to go and do 10 years in Lansing Penitentiary. And so I said, okay, I'm going to do it, you know? And we got married around that time and I came back and we were at St. Mark at the time and I got assigned to my probation officer. Come to find out, she sang in the choir at St. Mark. And so she said, hey, you pay all your fines, you do drug treatment, anger treatment, I'll get you off probation. I finished probation in 4.5 months.
Wow.
Okay? And so there was no underlying sentence to worry about, nothing, anything else. God just kept working on my life.
Yeah, that's how you should worry about
it. Yeah, that's how you should worry about it. And it was just amazing. God just started doing things to where my life just started moving forward and it was effortless. You know, and then I just started to learn to just trust God, and I got back into the Word, and then we started ministering to the youth, and then we had somebody bring us the Word of Life, and then that's when my life really took off, because when I started here, I was mowing grass, you know, for free, for like 9 months. 2.5 of those months, my wife was at basic training, so I was taking care of both of our kids and a dog, and I mean, some of y'all remember me at that time, I was a wreck, but you know, I was at church every Sunday, man.
I have to go pick up my daughter at work, but I've really enjoyed your testimony.
Yes, ma'am.
I didn't want you to think you were doing a bad job.
But
everybody's leaving. I'm trying to figure out what's up with that.
But you know, God elevated my life, and I started out here doing grunt work, and then they offered me the coaching position. And this year, going into it, I'll be the dean of students, and I handle. You know, all the international athletes coming in, and I'm not bragging on myself because I know this is all God, but I'm bringing in over $150,000 of tuition money from the students that I've recruited and brought in and are going to be paying students here. And I noticed that God just, he says, if you're available, I'll use you. Mm-hmm. You know, so I do that. I make myself available. You know, I even worked with Israel for a little while. I hated this, but... use a screwdriver, but whatever. So, I remember one time he had me digging a fence post out of concrete using a crowbar. So, you know, I'm very, yeah, he did it. I've been very humble, and I'm in a place right now, you know, when God started opening doors for me, and he started communicating with me, he gave me a vision. And he said, you won't win souls. He said, you will win souls for me, not by the hundreds, not by the thousands, but by the multitudes and the millions. And he would give me these dreams, and they were very vivid, you know, and then I would tell my wife, this is what God's going to do. And she said, okay, and then he would do it exactly like that, you know. And then I had this guy named Prophet Bless. And he's a great man of God, you know. And we only talk. Robert Bless. You know him? He is an amazing man of God. Amazing man of God. And so, you know, he calls me every once in a while when God has a word for me. And I told my grandmother, when God has a word for me, he always speaks through Prophet Bless. And so he said, come to one of my revivals. And I always put it off. And then about a year ago, I finally went to one.
At Holy Temple?
Yeah. Okay. At Holy Temple. And I remember the devil, I mean, he fought tooth and nail. You know, I think me and my wife bumped heads that day. The kids were being passed that day. I was like, I told him I'm going to go. And he called me down in front of this whole revival. And he said, you are an entrepreneur. You're going to become an entrepreneur. He said, you're going to become a millionaire. And you're going to have the largest ministry for the youth in the world. And this was before they asked us to be youth pastor at our Champion location. Right. This was before I was doing any ministry work with Word of Life. This was before I was, I mean, anything. I wasn't even working in the school at that time. And so I was like, oh, okay, you know, that's fine. But now I see how God is lining things up. And then, you know, when I met with Pastor Rob and I told him my vision, he was like, well, you're in the right place. And then about 6 months ago, he said, you pick a mission, and I'll pay for it. I'll wherever you want to go in the world. But the thing is, I ran from that for a long time, even with God dealing with me, because God has shown me that I'm not going to the friendly places. I'm going to go where the Christians are persecuted, you know? And then one time I had a dream, and he was like, this is why you went through everything you went through. This is why you got to see girls tied up and chained up so that you can have a heart for them. This is why you got to, see these different things, and this is why you got to smell what flesh smells like when it's burnt. You know, I've seen so many things. I wondered, like, why? Why did I do that? Because I had to have a heart. You know, I would always pray, God, give me your heart. Give me your heart, you know? I didn't know what I was praying for, you know? And one thing you learn about God isn't a genie. He doesn't just give you what you ask for.
That's right.
It comes through tests and perseverance and trials and tribulations. And so I was like, okay, and so one thing I've accepted in my mind, and I love my wife so much for this because, you know, not many wives support husbands with crazy visions that don't make sense.
Yeah, they are.
But, in this church, we know, you know, but just to the normal world, you know, I said, hey,
you're wrong. Go to that one.
There's not many women in the world, okay? I said, if they told their wives and their fiancés and girlfriends, they would leave them, you know? But if I say, hey, there's going to come a time where I'm going to go to the Niger Delta where Christians are being persecuted, and I'm going to have to leave you here with the kids while I go and do God's work. She's like, okay, you know? And I have that support in whatever I do. And you know, so God has given me this vision, and he's given me this fire that's on the inside of me. And, you know, it's crazy, but I thank God for what I went through. You know, I'm thankful that he brought me out of it, but I'm thankful that my eyes got to see it and my hands got to feel those things and my mind got to think those things because I know where people are that are addicted to drugs, you know? And it's not the person, it's what's going on the inside of them. You know, I can't make my mind up to be mad at a person. You know, my dad spent almost every day of my living life in jail. You know, when he died, I wasn't mad at him. You know, and I found out a lot of things about
him. Passed to some.
Yeah, he died in December.
In jail?
Yes.
From an illness?
Mm-hmm. About 20 different illnesses. It was terrible. And my mother died a year before that, you know, which I didn't even get to that story. But it was, you know, it was just a terrible thing. And, you know, to where I would go through these trials and tribulations to where it was like physically, it would physically hurt my body, you know. Like when my dad died, my wife would tell you, like, my body physically hurt, you know, and I would have to curl up in a ball, and all I could do was cry, and you know. But one thing about God, man, he's awesome, and he's faithful, and he will perform, you know. And so, if I can encourage anybody, I don't know where everybody is with their walk, you know. If I can encourage you with anything, if you don't know how to do this walk, first, you know, be available. You know, be available. Be around people that are doing this thing. Because just like bad influences, this stuff rubs off on you. You know, if you're around somebody that's on fire, it's impossible not to be on fire with them. Wow. You know? And take the things that you've learned in life and know that God can use those things for good. That's what He specializes in. I never understood why I was addicted to ecstasy pills when I never even had a drink in college. But now, if I see a person whose teeth, you know, are flat from the front to the back, and you know, they're really, really skinny, and I ask them, "Hey, what's your issue?" and they tell me, I know how to bring them out of that lifestyle, you know, and I can relate to everybody across the board. Whether you're a rich, snobby kid whose parents buy you Porsches for your graduation gift, or if you're a gang member, seventh grader who's trying to decide if the streets are really for you, I've covered every spectrum of that. And I thank God for that. So, you know, when you see me, you have to know one thing about me. I am not ashamed. I tell God, you send me wherever you want to go, and I'll do it. I'll preach it. I'll say it. I don't care who I'm standing up against, because this one thing I know. The weapon will come. It may hurt. It may knock me down. It may cause me to have to get stitches, physical, you know, pain, but it won't prosper. You know, I've made up my mind that if I got sent to Africa and I died for the cause, then it's going to ignite something in America where a million people are going to go on my behalf, on God's behalf, you know, and war. And that's just what I believe, and absolutely believe. So when I tell you that I'm a believer and I'm a follower of Christ, it isn't just so that I can look like a good Christian. I'm a follower of Christ. You send me to the darkest places, I'll go. I'm not afraid. Send me to South Chicago and I will go, you know. Send me to the blood neighborhood in All Blue and I'll preach the gospel. I'll do it. You know, I'll go to Mexico City. I'll go anywhere. And I'm not saying this because the camera's on me. I legitimately mean that. And so, you know, I want to end on this. If you look at this sheet, you know, in the bottom right-hand corner, that's a picture of my family. And, you know, right above it is my mugshot. And I'll pass this around because it's a little bit lighter copy, you can see. But, you know, I'm a firm believer that God makes all things new. And if that's not proof that God makes all things new, then I don't know what else is proof. If I told you that I detoxed my wife, you know, when I was detoxing and I was on the run, I didn't get to that part of the story, but, you know, I was living at K96 in the weekly hotel for 2 months. She was there every night with me, you know, and I was addicted to drugs and I had to quit cold turkey because the people I used to get my pills and weed from wanted to kill me because I was going to get a drug shipment and the state trooper literally took $15,000 from him. And he said, what are you going to do about it? He's like, I can book you with it. You know, do you want to go to jail? I just got out of jail 2 days before that. So he literally took $15,000. How do you explain that to the OG of Bloods and the OG of Crips? That's $3,000 of yours and $5,000 of yours just got taken by a state trooper. They're not hearing that. I want my money in 24 hours or there's a ticket on your head. So I literally detoxed, throwing up, crying, not sleeping, starving, everything. And she was there with me the whole time. God makes all things new. All things new. There's nothing too far left or too far right that God cannot restore. And my family, I love my family. I love my kids. You know, we have a beautiful house out in Goddard now. And my life is brand new. It's restored. So spread the word. Let people know, like, you know, God is in the renewing business. He revamps. He makes all things new. And then He can elevate you to a spot that you can never, ever do on your own. I could have never done these things on my own. If you'd asked me, even last year, if I'd be the dean of students and the head football coach and head of recruiting, I'd be like, no, you know, I don't know what I was going to do, but I wouldn't have been doing that. So, what I want to end with is inviting anybody who maybe hasn't accepted God into their life, or maybe you have, or you haven't fully accepted Him. Maybe you haven't made it to that breaking point where the only place to go now is up, okay? Rock bottom, when you can't go any lower. I don't know where you are in your life, but if you desire a closer walk with God, I want to pray with you right now. If you're struggling with anything, I still have struggles. No matter what your struggle is, no matter how big it is, God is bigger than anything that is going on in our life. Anything. Or maybe there's somebody in your family that you want to intercede for, you want to stand on the behalf for. I want to pray for that right now. So if everybody would just close their eyes and bow their heads and have an attitude of prayer. I don't know how you guys normally close, but this is how I just want to close my section of it. Dear Heavenly Father, I come before you as I do many times. And the first thing I want to do, Lord, because since the last time I prayed, I've sinned. And I've fallen short and I've missed the mark. So I want to ask for forgiveness and I want to repent, Lord. And I repent because I know that I'm saying to you, Lord, I recognize my sins and I'm aware of them and I'm going to do everything in my power with your help to correct them. Lord, I also ask these things because I know I cannot ask you for anything while I have baggage. You know, Lord, if there's anything in my heart that is held against somebody else, Lord, I forgive them, whether it's known to me or unknown, Lord, just have your spirit search my heart and remove all things, Lord. And then I intercede on behalf of those people who want a closer walk with you, Lord, who say, Lord, I've made the commitment. I may not be seeing change like I want to. It may not be moving at the pace that I wanted to, Lord, but I'm still believing in you, Lord. I ask that you give them strength. I ask that you give them courage and give them an absolute a strengthening of faith to let them know that if they will just have absolute confidence in you and be assured of the things that they cannot see, having faith, you would do those things. You're faithful to those things. Lord, if there's somebody here who has a family member who is struggling and they want to see them do better, Lord, I speak out on their behalf. Lord, send your angels to war on their behalf because this isn't a war of flesh and blood, Lord. It's spirits and it's principalities and it's things that we can't see with our own natural eyes. So we command the angels to go and war on their behalf, Lord. And we want to see a absolute move, Lord, a reviving. That when we look at these things, we can see you in them. Give us our spiritual eyes, Lord, your spiritual eyes. Give our ears, your heart, our heart, Lord. And I said that I used to pray that prayer and not know. But Lord, I pray for your heart and we pray for your heart. And I pray that you will open the hearts of these people, whether it be through trials, tribulations, revelations, Lord, or through their testimony, Lord. Open their eyes to your goodness in their life and help them. Give them a fire, a burning fire, Lord, that they cannot deny you and that they have to go and tell somebody and they have to bring somebody and they have to spread the word, Lord, because the fields are plentiful, Lord. There's so much that's out there, Lord, but the laborers are few and we need them, Lord. So everybody that's assigned to us, minister to their hearts. So that when we go on your behalf, Lord, whether it's one word or 100 words, it will be a word that they cannot deny, which will be you. When we open our mouth, Lord, you will speak. We are vessels and we're willing to be used. Help us make ourselves available, Lord, because that is how you can use us. Whether it's for the dark places, Lord, or to the high places. Whether it's the dry places, Lord, or the dark places, shed your light. And we know that you need us through to be able to work on earth and through people here on earth. So work through us as we make ourselves available. Lord, we ask for an absolute move like none other. Yes. One that is impossible to man. One that man cannot wrap his mind around. Lord, you've given me the vision that one day the world, Lord, will cry your name and there will be not one man who will deny you. Atheists, Buddhists, Lord, Muslims, all will proclaim that you are God, Lord. And it starts right now with this seed of prayer and the people in this room and the seed that is planted that you will nurture and you will grow that cannot be stopped. It cannot be denied by the enemy. And we cancel any assignment that the enemy has against anybody in this room and anybody attached to us, our family, our friends, our enemies, those who speak against us, Lord. We ask for the absolute blessing, anointing, and favor to go before us so that your work can be done. We ask all these things in your Son's name so that you, the Father, will be glorified in all things. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.